No, you are correct in that. I cannot claim to be your brother as this rabble can. I am not Lorgar's son. I am his father. You would do well not to forget it.
The sons of the Emperor would each be molded by the environments and mentors of their homeworlds. Some would be raised on feral death worlds, teeming with deadly predators, whilst others would bask in the light of civilizations blessed with technology, culture, and community. Yet each Primarch would shoulder their own burdens, and most would not be fortunate enough to be raised by benevolent or kind fathers. For today, we shall elucidate the deeds of the man who would twist a son of the Emperor to the path of damnation, self-pity, and hubris. The Dark Cardinal of the Word-Bearers, Kor Phaeron. The Master of Mankind would craft 20 inheritors of his legacy to unite humanity across the stars. Individually gifted with traits beyond mortal attainment, the sons of the Emperor would be installed to lead the armies of the Angels of Death to bring compliance to the galaxy and pave the way for a universe united in purpose, peace, and prosperity. Yet with the intervention of the malevolent beings of the warp, the sons of the Emperor would be cast across the galaxy and raised on disparate worlds. For one such child would descend upon the feudal world of Colchis, a planet steeped in superstition and zealotry. Ruled by the theocratic covenant of Colchis, religious piety would be the principle by which its members would attain supremacy. Unknowingly worshipping the ruinous powers and their acts of praise, the doomed peoples of Colchis would seek the guidance of the Covenant's priests for the favor of their so-called great powers. For among these puppets of chaos, a priest of the Covenant would champion the aggressive subjugation and conversion of his people, Kor Phaeron. Exiled for his extreme methods from the capital city of Varadesh, Kor Phaeron would gather his remaining followers and venture to the nomadic tribes of the planet, seeking new converts to his cause. Among the peoples known as the Declined, Kor Phaeron would meet with a boy of immense potential. Named Lorgar, the boy known as the Raincaller would project an aura of the Emperor's power, to which Kor Phaeron would exploit. Ordering his followers to slaughter the nomads of the Declined, Kor Phaeron would adopt Lorgar into his caravan of cultists and mentor the boy in the teachings of the great powers. Physically and emotionally abusive to the young boy, Kor Phaeron would instill the tenets of the Covenant under Lorgar. Seeing visions of a figure wreathed in gold, Lorgar would proclaim his foresight of the one god of mankind to his guardian. Rejecting the notion of such hallucinations, Kor Phaeron would berate Lorgar for his blasphemous ideas. Yet with time, Lorgar's immense charisma, honed through the teachings of the Old Faith, would begin to draw followers to his cause. Known as the Godsworn, the disciples of the now matured prophet of the Emperor would listen reverently to Lorgar's promise of the One. Kor Phaeron would relent in his scorn of Lorgar's visions, by virtue of the followers now flocking to his side. Manipulating Lorgar to achieve his own ambitions, Kor Phaeron's control would over time nonetheless diminish. His men would no longer acquiesce to beat Lorgar for his transgressions against his guardian and refuse to punish their now ascended prophet. Proclaiming his son as the bearer of the word, Kor Phaeron would aid his foster son in his holy war against the old ways of the Covenant of Colchis. Serving as Lorgar's chief advisor, the now Archdeacon of Colchis would watch Lorgar's Godsworn overwhelm the rule of the Covenant and form his own Dark Heart branch of the faith in secret. Bearing no allegiance to Lorgar's vision, Kor Phaeron would wait and gain influence until an opportunity to restore the faith of the great powers would present itself. Varadesh would fall to the Godsworn as the populace hurled the corpses of the former ruling ecclesiarchs and hierarchs from the walls of the City of Grey Flowers. Colchis would universally praise the teachings of the one god of humanity, and Kor Phaeron would be installed as the new High Priest of the Covenant. With further schisms fracturing the faith of Colchis, after 6 years of bloody war, the Great Purge of Colchis would begin. Colchis would praise the divinity of the Emperor, as the old faith would be assimilated into the teachings of the One. For soon, their devotion would be rewarded with the arrival of the Master of Mankind to Colchis. Alongside the Cyclops of Prospero, Magnus the Red, the Emperor would descend upon Colchis. The peoples of the faith Lorgar had created would bow and weep at the sight of their divine patron's visage. The Emperor would impart the rule of the Imperial Heralds to his returned son, and with Lorgar reinstated as commander of the 17th, he would name them the Word Bearers. Yet as the most promising warriors of Colchis would be installed among the ranks of the 17th, Kor Phaeron would prove too old to undergo the procedures to ascend to the stature of an Astartes. Undergoing intense rejuvenate treatments and costly surgical bionic and gene forge procedures, Kor Phaeron would transform into a transhuman warrior. Regarded with distaste by his peers, the newly installed first captain of the Word Bearers would be regarded by the 17th as a false Astartes. Deemed impure by the standards of the Space Marines of his own legion, Kor Phaeron would regardless serve his legion as his Primarch's most esteemed subject. A fanatical and ruthless commander, Kor Phaeron would not only fulfill the role as leader of the Legion's elite first company, but also a chaplain, spiritual leader of the 17th. Eradicating humanity's enemies across the stars, the Word Bearers would bring worlds into compliance and erect grand monuments dedicated to the worship of the Master of Mankind. Lorgar would pen the Lectitio Divinitatis as his Legion preached the word of the One to the conquered foes of the Imperium. Yet such a contradiction to the Emperor's imperial truth would not go unpunished. With the Word Bearers' slow and heretical progress during the Great Crusade, answered with reprisal. Monarchia, a hive city of immense splendor, crafted in devotion to the Emperor, would be the greatest symbol of Lorgar's deeds as a Primarch of the Imperium. The city cast in gold, ivory and marble, would be an affront to the Imperium's ideals of secularism and human progress. Dispatching the 13th Legion, the Ultramarines, the Master of Mankind would order the Sons of Gilliman to tear down Lorgar's perfect city. Monarchia would burn as the Emperor uses psychic might to force the Word Bearers to kneel and bear witness to their transgression. Rebuked for their zealous worship, the shamed Legion would be fertile ground for Kor Phaeron's chance to bring resurgence to the teachings of the Great Powers. Upon the Word Bearer's flagship, the Fidelitas Lex, Lorgar would wallow in contemplative isolation for a solar month. Mourning the Emperor's censure for his actions, Kor Phaeron and the First Chaplain, Erebus, would tend to their liege's broken pride. Kor Phaeron would proffer that if the Emperor would not accept his Primarch's praise, perhaps another pantheon would prove more benevolent. Converting Lorgar to the dark gods of the old faith once more, the bearer of the word would pilgrimage into the Eye of Terror to converse with his new gods. Returning to real space, empowered with the favor of the ruinous powers, Lorgar would lead his word bearers to bring new worlds into compliance, to covertly give worship to his new benefactors. Kor Phaeron would be named Master of the Faith for his unflinching loyalty and service to the old gods. For soon, they would reveal their true allegiance to the gods of chaos, with the fall of the Emperor's most cherished son, Horus Lupercal. The War Master of the Imperium would betray the Emperor with his fall to the ruinous powers, and begin his great gambit to sunder humanity. Aware of the Emperor's reprisal for his actions, the Lupercal would task Lorgar with crippling their most dangerous foe, the Ultramarines, before revealing their duplicity to the Imperium. Already embittered towards the 13th, Lorgar would relish the opportunity to humble the Lords of Ultramar and order Kor Phaeron to muster a contingent of the Legion within the Kulf system. presenting themselves to be returned and humbled brothers-in-arms to the Ultramarines, the Word-Bearers would position their forces to enact their bloody betrayal. Slaying countless unarmed and unarmored Ultramarines as their blades struck without warning, the Word-Bearers would begin the now infamous Battle of Kalf. Poisoning the system's sun and irradiating the planet of Kalf, Kor Phaeron's forces would attempt to destroy the Ultramarines' Gloriana-class void ship, the Macragge's Honor, from within as they jettisoned Rebute Gilliman into the void of space. Unable to slay the Ultramarines' Primarch, nor destroy his flagship, Kor Phaeron would confront Rebute Gilliman personally, wounding Gilliman with a shard of the corrupting Anapheme. Kor Phaeron's endeavor to turn the Primarch of the Ultramarines to the traitor cause would be rewarded with the Lord of Ultramar tearing one of Kor Phaeron's transhuman hearts from his body. Retreating to his void ship, the Infidus Imperator, Kor Phaeron would tend to his wounds and flee from the now mobilized Ultramarines fleet. Yet Kor Phaeron's flagrant attack on the citizenry and defenders of Kalf would demand retribution. Marius Gage, first chapter master of the Ultramarines, would be tasked by Rebute Gilliman to lead a task force to destroy the blasphemously named Infidus Imperator, or False Emperor, and bring Kor Phaeron to justice. Pursuing the fleeing Word-Bearers into the warp, the Macragge's Honor, now commanded by Gage, would not relent in its chase. Ashamed at his inability to defeat the Ultramarines' Primarch, Kor Phaeron would settle for the destruction of the Macragge's Honor and order his vessels to confront the larger warship. Infiltrated by the assault force of Aerion Mercerore and outmaneuvered by the Ultramarines' vessels, the Infidus Imperator would be destroyed. Yet Kor Phaeron would escape judgment by carving a hole through reality using his shard of the Anapheme. Transported to the demon world of Sicaris within the Eye of Terror, Kor Phaeron would begin the fortification and formation of a base of operations upon the world destined to be the Legion's new homeworld. Yet despite the Dark Cardinal's assault of Kalf and summoning of the Ruinstorm across the galaxy by Erebus, the Word-Bearers had failed to destroy the Ultramarines. For the remainder of the Horus Heresy, the now battle-scarred and fragmented forces of the 17th Legion would see few engagements in comparison to their traitor brethren. Lorgar would attempt to usurp the Warmaster of Chaos, and in the wake of his failure, the traitor war effort would fail. Horus Lupercal would be slain by the Master of Mankind, and the remaining traitor legions would retreat into the Eye of Terror. Humbled, shamed, and defeated, the traitor legions would devolve into war bands as their scattered shards of their former might remained a deadly yet diminished blight among the stars. Yet the Word-Bearers alone would remain a unified and resolute legion of the Dark Gods. Staging their forces upon their new homeworld of Sicaris, the Word-Bearers would continue to harry the Imperium and spread their profane beliefs to the innocents of conquered worlds. Installing Dark Apostles to lead the Word-Bearers' Dark Council, Kor Phaeron would remold his legion to best fulfill the will of their malevolent patrons. Lorgar Aurelian would ascend to the form of a demon prince of Chaos Undivided, with the Word-Bearers renewed in purpose at the vindication of their liege's ascension. Forgoing command to conduct deep meditations, Lorgar has remained within the Templum Inficio for 10,000 years as Kor Phaeron and Erebus wrestle for control of the Legion in his stead. Enacting wars of faith across the stars, the Word-Bearers, now led by their Dark Cardinal, slay and convert billions to fulfill their vision of a universe ruled by their pantheon. Forming the Brotherhood within the Word-Bearers' Legion, Kor Phaeron would scheme to remove Erebus from power by staging a coup to reclaim the Legion, yet fail with the betrayal of the Dark Apostle, Marduk. Renouncing the Brotherhood, Kor Phaeron would retain his leadership of the Word-Bearers, yet incur further animosity from Erebus. Launching Chaos invasions within the Teledus system, Segmentum Solar, and Veritas Subsector, Kor Phaeron would forge temporary alliances with the Iron Warriors, Night Lords, and other minor Chaos Lords to further the objectives of his Legion. housed within his artificer suit of cataphracti pattern terminator armor, the Terminus Consularius, Kor Phaeron continues to hold on to life with the favor of the gods of chaos and his own twisted desire to serve their whims. For the sermons of the Dark Cardinal continue to this day within the era Indomitus, much to the dismay of the Imperium and its most noble subjects.
Is it so wrong of me to walk the ways of a visionary, a seeker, rather than a simple soldier? What is it within my father that renders him so thirsty for blood? Why is destruction the answer to every question he has asked?
Kor Phaeron clutched Lorgar's shoulder tighter.
Because, my son, he is gravely flawed. He is an imperfect god.
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Kor Phaeron would prove pivotal in the damnation of the Imperium and its ideals, as such wretched mentors can corrupt even the most pure and well-meaning of individuals. Should you find yourself at the mercy of a tyrant, you must with all your will reject their honeyed words. For should you acquiesce to their demands, you may find yourself a shadow of your former self, and none can forge your path but you alone, and it is up to you to reject malevolence and manipulation in your pursuit of purpose.